Welcome to Checkpoint this day, and we want to focus on the Auditor General's report. So let me introduce you to my panel tonight. We have Karithi Murimi, a face you know very well on Checkpoint. Johnson Sakaja as well, thank you for making the time. The chair of TNA, that's the National Alliance Party.
The National Alliance, yes.
And we have Kwame Owino, who's from the Institute for Economic Affairs. All right, so your views are coming in, and I just want to read this on SMS from SNK, who's a human resource consultant. You say, the academic and professional qualifications of the accounting officers should be investigated. Incompetence begets incompetence. The accountants, as you put it, should have their licenses withdrawn, and they should be apprehended for masquerading as accountants. So let's get into that issue. Obviously, he's taken aside. But this is one of those topics that has just gone down. Kwame, let's start with you. This money, according to the Attorney General's office, the Auditor General's office, was unaccounted for.
Yep.
I think we've gotten things a little mixed up. Unaccounted for, misappropriated, stolen, looted, that sort of thing. Let's just start with a definition for you, what this means.
Well, unaccounted for means that the auditor walks to an office, goes to who's supposed to be the accounting officer or person keeping the records. And the records that are presented to him don't match the purposes for which the funds are. It may be for many reasons. One of them is that, look, vouchers are missing or anything, but the money has been spent according to the bank. So you cannot do reconciliation. That means that that money isn't accounted for. So you're not really sure that it was actually used to buy specific equipment, used to pay specific salaries, or used to do the functions for which it is. So you cannot actually track the shilling right back to the route for which it was intended.
All
so
right.
Records don't exist, or somebody's not answering questions.
John,
it may be just that records don't exist and they've been misplaced, or it may be that yes, it's also possible that some of it might be taken illegally.
All right, okay. Yeah. We'll come to you, Johnson, in a moment. Karithi, why is the Office of the Auditor General very important? Because at this point things have taken a little bit of a political heat in looking at an individual rather than the function of the office. But tell us why this office and the process of auditing government expenditure is very important, and we'll get to Johnson to just talk to us about that in a moment.
I think let's first get two big points out of the way. The first is that it's not the Treasury or any of the Cabinet Secretary who are asking for audit. It's Wajiku. Remember, the construct of our constitution right from the starting says the sovereign power belongs to the people of Kenya. Mm. It then goes to Article 2 to say all people exercise that power for and on behalf of Wajiku. So by the time you reach the Auditor General, it's a constitutional office mandated to audit accounts of the various public monies. And what we are hearing, basically, and the Kenyans need to understand this correctly, and more important, Treasury itself, is that we changed Article 229 from the old controller and auditor. Remember, we had a controller and auditor in the old constitution.
Yes.
The current one, which is the Auditor General, he is given a constitutional deadline under 229, which is within 6 months after the end of the year, he has to submit the audit to Parliament. So what we are hearing is basically the first chemistry disconnect, where the word 6 months is being respected by the Auditor General for and on behalf of Wajiku. He then gives the report to Parliament. The media and anybody else are getting the data from Parliament, not from the Auditor General. So that concept, which is now the one we are exercising for the first time, will always bring an element of discomfort.
Okay.
Because
right.
I have given a report, say, on the 30th of December 2014, which is the end of 6 months in the Constitution.
All right.
You as my auditee, who happens to be the ministry, you come on the 2nd of January 2015, and you say, oh, in fact, the answers are here. But remember, the report is already with the Parliament.
Okay, all right, so we understand that. Johnson, is this the scandal that never was? We've heard of the response from the National Treasury saying, but it didn't have final audit review meetings with the accounting officers.
First of all, thank you for inviting me. It's been a while since I was on the
Checkpoint.
Let me say that one, it is not necessarily a scandal. Because if you look at it, they're talking about expenditures that are yet to be explained, or that were not explained by the time, as Karelia said, the audit was done. I have seen the report. I've also seen the response from Treasury, and both of them make a lot of sense. If you look at the audit process, and such audits are very important. They're governed by international standards. You know, if you look at ISA regulations, International Standards of Auditing, number 260, talks about the importance of the management meetings, the exit meetings. If you look at the International Standards for Supreme Audit Institutions, also talks about objectivity and partiality, and the need for that exit meeting. The audit process is very clear. You know, in the beginning, you go there, you set up, you know, the entry meeting, where you discuss the scope that the audit is going to take. You know, that we're going to look at this and this and this will require the following from you.
Mm-hmm.
After that, of course, the auditor's staff undertake the audits, and thereafter they raise queries. You see, after the queries are raised, there's time for management to respond to a lot of those queries. That is a part that seems to have been missing,
okay,
contrary to the standards that are international.
Mm-hmm.
Also, if you listen to the Auditor General, he says, you know, I mean, as has been explained very well, he also has deadlines to work with.
Mm-hmm.
So these institutions need to be reading from the same page. If you look at the 67 billion examples you've given, the Office of the Attorney General,
mm-hmm,
they're saying that out of the budget of 3.3 billion in the 2013-2014 financial year,
mm-hmm,
2.7 billion cannot be accounted for,
yeah,
meaning that is 85% of his budget.
Right.
And out of 3.3 billion, 1 billion is personal emoluments.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how can he not account for that? 1.2 billion is to various institutions. So it is illogical that 2.7 billion has been looted.
Okay.
But on the other hand, you know, we need to find, and this is the role the Parliament is going to take.
Yeah.
When were the responses given? Were they given on time?
Mm-hmm.
If they were given on time, why were they not incorporated?
Right.
Because for you to have a final audit, you must incorporate the final responses.
Yes, okay. Kwame, when we talked about this, you disagreed and said, but the government knew that the Auditor General has a deadline to meet. Some people are reading mischief into that, saying, well, but you know, they knew when the date was and they just failed to account in time, and
yeah,
now saying, oh, but wait, the documents are available.
Well, it's really unfortunate, because if the response I read in the newspapers is what the considered opinion of Treasury is, it's completely unfortunate. I think I've always held in high esteem the cabinet secretary. Tends to be very mild-tempered and obviously understands that role. Rarely takes a foot wrong, but this time he's completely mistaken. One, the standards of auditing are not only about international standards. They are also stated within the Public Finance Management Act on one side, the Public Audit Act, and the Constitution itself, which actually says what the auditor should look for. So if you come back later, the mere fact that somebody failed to provide the audit statements when they are required to make those verifications means they've already broken the law. So for the minister to come up here and tell Kenyans that we actually had them, but he didn't look at them because they were not provided on time, means he's saying somebody in my office broke the law, but now let's attack the messenger because we can't deal with the message. And if Parliament takes the view that I hear, which is very mild, which is that you need to give them a point, I'm not too sure. As usual, we are making this the political thing, which is blame the opposition or blame somebody else or say that it is a political matter. If we are spending 2 trillion shillings, we are spending 2 trillion shillings and we do not have specific vouchers and ledgers to allow the... Remember, we have internal auditors as well,
mm-hmm,
who knew what they're required to do and therefore should have helped with preparing for this. And if those records are not there, I hope we'll have time to go to the details of some of them.
Mm.
If the records are not there, already the law has been broken. It's bad for Parliament to come here, or any parliamentarian to come here, and try to focus public attention on the fact you need to give them time to respond in the pace that they want. The Constitution has not provided a suggestion for space. All these institutions have to be done, and they must be done within a specific deadline. If you have not provided that, even in the private sector, if you have not provided that in time, then basically the board, in this case Parliament, has to deal with why isn't it being provided in time.
Okay.
That's the point.
What I'm saying, first of all, Nona said that there's a limitless time to respond to this. But what Parliament has to establish, because what you're hearing is that some of those could have been provided on time but are not incorporated. That would be a very serious issue, you know, if some of the responses were provided within the stipulated time and have not been incorporated. All of this must be established, you know. No one can say with authority that all of them were not provided by a certain time. or not until Parliament takes the process. And that is part of the process. You know, if you look at our laws, the PFM Act, the Constitution, the reason this is brought to Parliament is that it's being brought to the representatives of the people to establish mm-hmm. that. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, if you look at the previous audit, for example, of 330 billion, when this was discussed in Parliament, it was... The Auditor General had been saying that 330 billion cannot be accounted for the previous year. Mm-hmm. When it was brought to Parliament, mm-hmm. it was clear that actually the amount was far, far less than that. It was not even 5 billion. You know, and for us, we're concerned. Is it that accounting officers within government are not able or are not, you know, prosecuting their mandate as should be?
Okay.
Because that is also a matter of concern for mm-hmm. us. The Jubilee government is very keen on rooting out corruption, and we even in Parliament, I mean, I sit in the public, in the Finance Committee in Parliament, mm-hmm. we've worked very hard to see how we can strengthen the independent office of the Auditor General, if you look at the current public audit bill. But that independence must also be objective and impartial. And additionally, accounting officers within government must also play their part. They must be able to play their part. Now, if individuals are politicizing it and talking about the individual,
mm-hmm.
because I look at the Auditor General as the office of the Auditor
yes.
General. If they're looking at the individual,
right.
That is unfortunate. That is the nature of politicians, but that's not what we are focusing on. We want to see the facts.
Okay.
Because it is it is almost, you know, raining on our parade after Kenya is being hailed for its fight against corruption.
Absolutely.
And it's in our interest, especially in Jubilee, to make sure that not only is the institution of the Auditor General, his office, working independently and providing what we require as government, but also that people within government, the civil servants, are also playing their part.
All right, and accountable for the use
yes.
of funds. Karevi, some people are saying, but should we trust Parliament to do this? Parliament has not had a very good record over the last year or so, including the Public Accounts Committee itself.
It was changed.
And it was changed. But if you recall, some of the allegations were raised about corruption and who received money from whom to bury certain reports. And we know how that ended up. Nothing happened. All we did was change the office holders. And again, as we say this, Nicholas Gumbo was invited to come here. It's unfortunate that he was held up in Kisumu. Should we trust Parliament now? Because, of course, that's the natural progression. Auditor General takes it to Parliament. Parliament then starts to do that.
I think the spirit of Parliament mm-hmm. is that it is, the annual general meeting of the Kenyan population.
Okay.
So the report is like being tabled to AGM, and the members of Parliament are acting in trust. And within the spirit of Chapter 6, we hope that trust will not be directly misused.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's where the call or the appeal that no MP should discuss the actual report in terms of a political kind of a system.
Right.
To make things look better, because that's not the intention of the audit. Is a professional
process, yes.
exercise.
Right.
A report has been submitted to you.
Mm-hmm.
You are our board.
Mm-hmm.
That board, in terms of the concept of Parliament, first goes to a committee.
Mm-hmm.
So remember, the report mm-hmm. was tabled in the House.
Yes.
The House committed the report to Parliamentary Accounts Committee.
Right.
Parliamentary Accounts Committee should now start going through one by one. So the AG has no business, or even Rotich, to be honest with you, to answer any Kenyan.
At this point.
At this point.
Until
because it's not his role.
Until they go to
he's
Parliament.
Supposed to give, if he has to answer,
mm-hmm.
he's supposed to submit that report to the House Committee. Because
yeah.
technically we are discussing a House business activity
mm-hmm.
as non-MPs, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
So you who was audited, who happens to be a Cabinet Secretary, if you have to, at this stage, answer, you go to our AGM. Our AGM happens to be Parliamentary Accounts Committee.
Okay.
Parliamentary Accounts Committee is an open forum. So that committee, hopefully, whatever you tell them, Kenyans can read from there.
Okay.
But
all
now,
right.
the other point, which is fundamental,
yeah.
and we need to get this correct.
Yes, and let's have Sakaja in to respond to that.
A very fundamental point.
Uh-huh.
The moment an auditor tells you that I did not receive a report, it's irrelevant whether it is to do with the salaries. Because
yeah.
I may come to audit salaries,
yeah.
and the data is not in the employee's files. So when I'm auditing salary, I'm asking for the letter of employment. Maybe the staff were transferred, and the letters are yet to be filed.
Okay, all right.
Okay. Now, what I wanted to just, you know, my intervention was that Officially and through the structures, the cabinet secretary will also come. In fact, not even just the cabinet secretary, the accounting officers in different ministries and departments,
mm-hmm.
Will be able to come to Parliament and mm-hmm. and raise their side of the story.
Okay.
And bring up those issues, but it is also a bit restrictive to say that the cabinet secretary cannot comment on it, because even before it has been discussed, it's in the public domain, and there is an outcry, because when you say 67 billion, there is a thinking that of course will be used, whether it is politically or not, that 67 billion Kenyan shillings have been looted, and there's a new scandal. In fact, the first question you asked was this a scandal that never was?
Right.
It is a thin line between dealing with it just purely professionally, and also the
right.
implications.
So you think he was well within his right to comment
the
on this that was already in the public
and
domain?
And our constitution also talks about access to information.
Okay.
It talks about public participation.
Okay.
And it's important for him also to give his side.
Okay.
We should not restrict him.
But officially
he'll come to Parliament.
Let's call a speed of speech. Officially, what we are saying is he should have written that letter to Parliament.
Yeah.
To PSC.
No, not necessarily. He will be invited to PSC and he will raise the matter, because the matter is now within PSC. I think PSC has actually already
invited him.
And that is the process. Actually, he's invited by Parliament. That is the process. He doesn't need to ask for an invitation.
All
okay.
Right.
Can I come in on the question of whether Parliament is the right place?
Yes.
We have no choice.
Mm-hmm.
It's a constitutionally
yeah.
driven. Though it worries me that already Parliament has taken the view. The Auditor General is actually an officer for Parliament. So he shouldn't even be addressing himself to the cabinet secretary, with all due respect. So when you already see parliamentarians who've taken the view that this might be smearing our party or not, it worries me. But let me tell you, I think what I think. One, even if you take about the fact that yes, there are vouchers that might be available and they'll be corrected later, there are systematic things in those that you see. One of them is that no Kenyan should actually pretend, or rather, should be saying we are surprised. If you looked at last year's budgets as well, the kind of errors and misdemeanors that the Auditor General is reporting are actually systematic, in the sense that they're not new. Impressed is a big problem.
Right.
Payments for goods and services that are not delivered is a big problem.
Mm.
Checks that are written and are not cashed, a big problem. Cash books that do not exist, and the inability to reconcile what is in the cash book and what is in... That is a very big problem. And we're talking here of not simple change.
Mm.
20 million here and over time leading to... It's more than this 60
million. What he called a disturbing system of accounting.
Precisely.
Here was something else that
so
he
to
raised.
Then make it look like, look, we have to give these guys a chance. There's a big problem in public finance management in Kenya. If Parliament looks aside from that, we are cheating ourselves.
All right, let's raise a couple of issues and get into that. And I think the biggest one to start with is the $2 billion, from the sovereign fund that should have gone to the consolidated fund, but is then taken to an offshore account. Johnson, perhaps you can comment on this, because even in the Auditor General's report, he talked about release of funds for development, yes, but without the authority of the controller of budget from an offshore account.
You see, there are a lot of roles that the controller of budget actually should be playing, but unfortunately, even to this point, our office has not been playing some of those roles. For example, you see, audit is a continuous process, and I think every quarter she should be given a report on budget implementation. And I don't know if it is an issue with her getting some of these documents on time or not. On this specific issue, it is clearly against certain provisions of our law. If you look at the PFM Act, it's very clear, and even if you look at I think Article 206 of the Constitution,
mm-hmm.
is also extremely clear on that.
Mm-hmm.
That's a matter that we need to look at impartially within Parliament.
Uh-huh.
If somebody went against the law, they must be able to answer for it, because for us it's very clear, and the more Kwame says that politicians are trying to take sides, some of us, especially in the leadership of Jubilee,
mm-hmm.
are very keen, because we know very clearly the president and the deputy president have committed themselves to making sure they're running a clean government. If there are certain people within government who do not are not following or have not caught that vision, then they need to answer as individuals. So there is no political line. If something is wrong, I will say clearly this issue is wrong. It must be looked at. But what I'm asking for is objectivity, impartiality, and independence in the conduct of that. This is a matter that is clearly, that's a lot of money you're talking about.
Right.
It's money, I think, off the Eurobond,
yes,
that should be treated in a certain way. It has not been looted. You know, they're not saying the money has been looted or taken, mm-hmm, but it's been put in the wrong place. Putting money in the wrong place is itself also a crime. That also should not be done.
So misappropriation is also, a big deal, like John said.
It is a big deal. And you see, just to add, you see, when you see certain loopholes that are even systemic, as you say, in as much as ultimately, money may not be lost, these open opportunities for creative people, if they're creative people within government, to use this as an opportunity to actually loot funds. It can be used. So we're saying we need to tighten all these processes, and I hope, and unfortunately I'm not a member of the Public Accounts Committee, but I do hope that even our members from within our coalition, the entire membership of that committee, will be able to look at these issues objectively.
All right.
From both sides.
Actually, now that you've mentioned that, and we played this soundbite earlier from Nicholas Gumbo, who was spoke this yesterday and said, but everybody's looking to Parliament as if Parliament can solve all the problems. Parliament does not have prosecutorial powers. They will only make recommendations on person X, Y, Z, who was found to not have accounted for that money. Do you agree with that statement?
I respond to that. I wish he was here because I'd look him in the face and tell him he hasn't read the Constitution. Mm-hmm. I mean, I say that with utmost respect. Mm-hmm. Parliament has enormous powers in terms of reducing misdemeanors around public finance. And not to look like I'm lecturing, look, if a certain ministry has impressed spending of 150 million shillings, okay, Parliament can do this. Our Constitution gave Parliament the opportunity to be a budget-making Parliament, not a rubber-stamp budget. So you simply call the Cabinet Secretary and say, look, you have not accounted for 600 million from last year for this and that amount. We will chop your budget by 600 million until you repair this question.
Okay.
So when you hear parliamentarians say that we do not have, either they haven't read the Constitution or they are still under the thumb of the executive. And that's what I suspect it is. They think that Treasury should tell them what to do. Sorry. It is Parliament that is a budget-making body. Everything else that the Cabinet Secretary does in terms of bringing in budget proposals are proposals. It is Parliament to decide, we are giving you 2.25 trillion to spend. Why? Because we will be responsible to explaining to our constituents who elected us why we allow you to tax them. Uh-huh. So when a parliamentarian comes up here and says, what should we do?
Uh-huh.
That's not being very creative.
It's very important for government to stop generalizing.
No.
When you say parliamentarian, say Honorable Gumbo or say so and so.
Because generally, when we generalize
parliamentarians, then there's a feeling that all parliamentarians are thinking that. We're
so
not thinking
not
that way.
One,
I know what Article 95-96 talks about, the role of Parliament, especially within this new constitution. It's not only an enhanced role; it is actually that sovereign power that has been, delegated by the people. Parliament actually has the mandate to take care of our resources. Of course, we are not going to take somebody and jail them, but there are certain measures that we have.
Yeah.
Budget-making powers is saying we're the institution that does appropriation, and the reason why there are new timelines by when the Auditor General should give certain reports, by when the controller of budget should be able to give reports on the utilization of budget, is so that when we're doing when we're undertaking the budget process, we don't get shocked and say, what was your absorption in the last year? It is only 40%. Why are you giving you 40%? And also, if these documents are available on time, we should be able to say that, look, if you have not been able to account for X amount of money, you need to do it by this time. If you have not done it, we will not give you that money for you to implement your work. So actually, Parliament has a role. And I'm very confident about the reconstituted Public Accounts Committee.
Okay.
I know the other one came under fire for a lot of issues that were, looked at within Parliament.
Yeah.
We have a lot of faith. And the day Honorable Gumbo got elected as a chair, I told him, my friend, from whatever political divide, because we in Jubilee said, let us relinquish the seat to the opposition. But we said, we actually need you to be very firm, but very professional. Don't be political with the work of public audit. That is what we hope. That's what we're asking for. Let's not politicize
all
public
right.
audit.
Okay. Let's talk about some of the other issues that came up. Kari, the ghost NGOs apparently receiving money for, the war on HIV/AIDS and the spread of that. This one was particularly interesting. Apparently, the Nairobi County Commander collected 4.3 million shillings for approval of PSV licenses. That money was not surrendered to the ministry. that money never went to the county commander. No, the county commander. No, it's the county commander, actually. The county commissioner, you're right. Yeah. This money was not then forwarded to the exchequer, and in fact, exists no cash book for reconciliation of these funds.
That individual should be in court already. Simple. There's no philosophy around that. Yeah. I mean,
there's something I'm trying to find a language for Kenyans. You see, the reading of, when you go to Article 229, which is the Auditor General's article, mm-hmm. Under 2296, it requires the auditor to tell Parliament, one, the monies were spent lawfully, yeah. Two, it was value for money.
Yeah.
So any of the reports, in whichever nature you pick it in that report of the Auditor General, is basically any of those two sentences. And it's either saying, I was not able to see the raw, that's where the word sovereign comes in. I was not able to see value for money, mm-hmm. that's where that 4.3 of the NGO comes in.
Uh-huh.
I could not verify the NGO list with register of trade names,
mm-hmm.
because when you're auditing,
council, yeah.
you are comparing from one source to verify another.
Yeah.
So if you tell me I gave Murimi this money as an NGO,
mm-hmm.
me the auditor, I have an evidence quorum called list of registered NGOs by the Registrar of Societies.
Okay.
So if I tick and your name is not on the other side, I'll say I was not able to verify
okay.
why.
And
you are in the process of uh-huh. registering it.
I mean, credit.
That is also what.
But
we
how would you
be
given funds if you are still in the process of registering your organization?
No, that is a critical
thing. There are two things.
So for you, it's very cut and dry.
The other thing I want us to be very clear, because sometimes we may be too casual. The Office of Rotich, within the Public Finance Management Act, every 3 months under the law must be given an update by every ministry of government, every state corporation, every NGO on how public funds were spent for those 3 months. Then Wajiko said, because Rotich may not push the CS, let me also involve another person. So in Article 228, we have the Controller of Budget, mm-hmm. who is supposed to give a report to the two houses
yeah.
every 4 months. The two houses is Senate to represent what is happening in counties,
the
national government mm-hmm. to be reported through Parliament.
Okay. All right.
So let's call a spade a spade.
Uh-huh. Which is why
all these points
would
inside
like
the Auditor General's office, I mean
yes.
a report,
uh-huh.
one question I want PSC to follow. Within the 4 months controller's report,
uh-huh.
within the 3 months national treasury report, are the same items reported?
Yes. You see, the point is this. Everybody must align to the new constitution and the new PFM Act. I think there are people in different quarters, and even some of these independent offices, that are either still caught up in the old ways of public finance management. There was a very deliberate reason, and I know Chapter 12 was one of the chapters that was worked on the best. It was thoroughly worked on. And I remember even at that time, the National Treasury had no amendment when the Parliamentary Select Committee on the Constitution was in Naivasha, because I was also there as a consultant on different issues. Everybody must be able to play their role. What we are saying is that, on top of the Auditor General telling us how the money has been used, just doing the normal audit, we want to see the value for money audits as well as the performance audits, because the work he's doing is for the people of Kenya. The people of Kenya now, I mean, the Constitution has given them, not even given them, has actually acknowledged the immense power that the people hold, and through their elected representatives.
Right.
So even at this point, we may not like, or people might have some disaffection to the individuals within Parliament. Now it's up to the people within the next election, which is in 2 years and 6 days,
uh-huh.
to actually elect different people if that is an issue.
No.
But there has been a serious paradigm shift in the way public financial management is being done, and everybody really must get with the program.
All right.
Mm. Can I?
Yes, very quickly. I want us to go into a break, if you can be in a minute.
Okay. I think one other thing that you see in terms of a method is that the Parliamentary Service Commission, for instance, gets cited on very few occasions. in general, the commissions, the independent offices and the commissions in terms of adherence, well, with the exception of IBC and a few others that are perennial problems. But then again, that might be looked at as political, whatever it is. But I think there are specific institutions within the public sector that are actually very well attuned to the new methods.
Okay.
And so what that tells you is those that are refusing to do it, it's not because it's not possible. It's not because this is too onerous. It's just because they've decided we won't engage.
And of course the Parliamentary Service Commission is because of the strengthened budget office in Parliament.
All right.
I know that's something you've said very quickly. You must repeat it. Parliament as an institution as well has really been complying with the new law. That is because we deal with the law every day. But I think all of this is, all institutions must be attuned to it, as well as the office of the auditor. Everybody must play ball.
All right. Here's a question from Jeroge Nairobi. Says, who benefits from the interest earned from the offshore account monies, because already it's illegal, but it's Kenyan public money? Kwame?
I don't know. I think that's the first thing, that's perhaps what the Auditor General was suggesting. If somebody can actually short-circuit some processes and place this money in an offshore account somewhere for whatever number of months, because eventually the money came in, but it wasn't the money in addition to any interest. So obviously, I think that's something to search for. And parliamentarians should ask the Cabinet Secretary, how did this happen and who was responsible for that?
All right. The National Treasury, Kwame, has been very categorical on this, saying money being unaccounted for is not necessarily money stolen or money looted, and also talked about, you know, how this was being portrayed in the media, for example. Why is this so important, that money is unaccounted for? Just tell Kenyans again what that means and why they should be worried, if at all.
Well, I think Kenyans should be worried because money unaccounted for means that when the Auditor General came and they say the Treasury said we spent 100 shillings for this purpose, okay, and the Auditor General or his representative goes to the bank account and finds that yes, the money was spent, but either procedures were not followed or the documents to actually show that this amount of money was spent for this specific purpose and for a purpose that Parliament approved, if that trail is not available, then it means you can't account for that money,
mm-hmm.
in the sense that it could have been spent, yes, it actually probably has been spent, but you cannot say whether it was spent for a lawful purpose or whether the process was. So it's both a process question and also verification.
Okay.
So
we can't verify.
All right. Is it corruption? Corruption anyway is corruption,
mm-hmm.
you know, and we must be prepared to deal with that. But we should also not be very quick to cry wolf when it's not yet, when it's not corruption. And which is why I just elaborated the process,
mm-hmm.
you know, the audit process, the entry meeting, the audit work being done, the queries being raised, and the responses being all part of the audit. On this particular case, is that the responses are not part of the audit. So it is not that 67 billion has been lost. That is, no one has said that, not
right.
even the Auditor General.
Uh-huh.
But the point is, what we've been discussing is asking why either one, the management responses not incorporated, is it because they're not brought in time? If they're not brought in time, because there are new timelines within the law, then people need to answer questions to Kenyans. Why haven't you been able to perform your duty as stipulated within the law? And if it is not an issue of time, if it is actually, if we actually get documents to show that these reports were brought in time and they were not included,
okay,
then
that is
a whole other issue.
All right, but is it also entirely possible that some of that money wasn't spent for what it was meant for, and that receipts or documentation does not in fact exist and might be given after the fact? Is that also a possibility?
There is a possibility, but you see, with the new financial management systems, it is not like if you send somebody to buy a mango and they buy something else and they write a receipt. They're actually more, they're strict and stringent ways. It is almost impossible at this point with the current financial management system to actually cook up new documentation at this point. You can't, because the trail is there, and there's access to this financial management systems that we
All
have
right,
now.
Let's talk about the sovereign bond again,
yes.
for just a minute, because this was a big one for the Jubilee government, raising $2 billion for development projects,
yes.
In the country. does this worry you? This money was put in an offshore account.
Contrary to all of this.
Yeah.
Reading it how it has come out in the report, of course I'm extremely worried. This is one of the hallmarks of the government that went out. The Eurobond was heavily subscribed. It was very exciting.
Yeah.
Just to see how markets reacted to it, and of course it is money that we want to use for implementation of the Jubilee Manifesto. And the fact that it was not put in the right place and questions of interest come up, for us is a question that must be answered. We must get answers to that.
Are you concerned that the Treasury did not respond to this one specifically? Because even in the press releases we saw, they talked about, the accounting from government ministries and departments, but that the issue of the Eurobond was not raised. And surely some would say the Cabinet Secretary in Treasury would have known that the sovereign bond was not going into the consolidated fund and was sent to an offshore account. Surely this is not something that could have
missed his eye. The response that Treasury has done, first of all, as I said, is not the formal response that is required within the process of the law and the process of audit. The formal response is what he gave to the Attorney General, to the Auditor General, and what he will bring to Parliament. What he was reacting to as the Cabinet Secretary was the newspaper report, and he addressed the issues that were raised within the newspapers that that had come out at that time. It is definitely a matter of concern, and if somebody is culpable of this, they must pay for it. We have laws; they must take the cost. But what I'm saying is that it is important for us, to have seen what those responses were on those specific issues. They gave certain examples, Ministry of Livestock,
National Police Service,
mm-hmm. the issue of the 31 million or 24 million. So all of those things must be looked at. It is unfortunate that you see now that they're looked at after the fact that the Auditor General's report has been done, even the perception issues, will be something that will be negative on government, because these things must have been done earlier. That's why even us within Jubilee want to know why weren't these responses put into the report. And if indeed, again I must reiterate, if indeed we find that this were either the sent within good time, because there is trail of this documentation and were not put in, then we will start to query the professionality of the office. But if indeed they're put in at the right time, or rather if they're put in beyond the deadline, then we will question the competence of the accounting officers in those various ministries.
Okay, all right. The war on corruption, Karithi, what effect does this have on the war on corruption? Jubilee trying to make sure that they bring those culpable to book. And with the efforts we've seen in the war on corruption in the country, what does this say? Kenyans are worried. And in fact, most of the responses here say that money has been stolen, that money has been looted, that money has been misappropriated. What does this do in terms of perception and even the actual war on graft?
I think in terms of the war on corruption, what we need is to give Kenyans confidence that the system which they set will work. Let me be very specific. If I were CS Rotich and I wanted to make Kenyans agree that I'm serious, then I would table the total report in the newspaper and get every CS to insert his quorum of remarks, so that the pillar of individual accountability per ministry, per department, start talking to the ordinary Kenyan. So that you don't seem like you are covering, if you see what I mean. Because the moment you are having a few but not others, then Kenyans are left to do their judgment. Now, the war on corruption, I think Parliament here will have a very big law to play when they are looking at the whole area of the new Ethics Act. They can start agreeing that there are documents we should talk to each other. The auditor's report should be part of a DPP process.
Uh-huh.
The DPP should be able to agree that this is a report which requires a bit of further investigation.
Okay. All right.
The DPP outcome of that investigation should be a report Parliament should receive.
All right, Karithi, let me just cut you off for a moment. Yeah. I interviewed the Auditor General in 2013 when it just taken office. There was a suggestion then that perhaps that office should be given prosecutorial powers.
Officially, in terms we'll of in terms of what you call the concept of audit, the work of the auditor is an eye on behalf of the owner.
Yeah.
Now remember, we are not talking of Parliament's money. We are not talking of the executive money.
Uh-huh.
We are talking of Kenyan taxes.
Yes. Okay.
This tax has been paid by that street boy sitting in the street who has taken a soda, that soda has VAT. So when we talk of 66 billion cannot be seen, we are actually talking on a very personal level. It's health, it's education, it's all that. So in terms of prosecutorial processes, as long as the auditor process talks to the DPP process, I would have no problem myself.
Okay, so you don't
that's
think
where now Parliament,
powers are
to be
needed?
Honest with you, that's where the new PSC structure of discussing auditor report comes in, because the Constitution says Parliament will implement a public finance system with ability to implement their recommendations. That's what the Constitution says.
All right, let's bring in Sakaja for a moment. Prosecutorial powers? Yes, no?
Prosecutorial powers in the Office of the Auditor General?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think they should have prosecutorial powers. And this is because, you know, just simply if you look at the framework, not just our Constitution, but any governance structure around the world that has been successful, when you arrogate powers of different offices, you know, to other offices because of special reasons, you have less, you know, it is less effective.
Mm-hmm.
Even our own institutional framework of fighting corruption, I've seen severe weaknesses on it, and I've said this consistently from 2008 is the first time I wrote about it, that when you arrogate certain powers, either to investigate, that is ordinarily with the police and whatnot, and then to prosecute, that is ordinarily with the DPP, and you give one institution, and in that institution you have people who have peers in these other institutions, but they pay 10 times more because they are not supposed to be corrupted,
mm-hmm.
then you see systemic sabotage, you know, on that institution. So I believe arrogating the functions and the mandates of other institutions just because it's a big issue is not right. What we need to do is to strengthen institutions mandated to prosecute and to investigate.
Okay.
And I think Parliament should be able, there should be a very clear conveyor belt of how these matters are,
mm-hmm.
You know, are dealt with. Once these matters have been raised,
mm-hmm.
and even the final report is done, then it comes to Parliament.
Okay.
What happens to Parliament's recommendations? It must be a very clear chain and with timelines.
All right.
You know, there must be timelines.
What
do
you need to have one, just a quick
uh-huh.
one. When Martin was PS Treasury, Martin constituted what he was calling an executive agreement with the Parliament and the Treasury on
Martin.
Every
Martin. You're talking about Martin Oduro
Otieno.
On
every
Martin.
Well, they're on a first name basis.
Yeah. On every ministries reported to Parliament,
uh-huh.
there was an internal system between Parliament and Treasury, that this will be the executive follow-up activity.
Yes.
And this is the timeline.
Timelines are very
where
important.
Where Treasury will report compliance of the recommendation or non-compliance.
Okay.
And why.
All right.
So
very quickly.
In short,
yes.
Every item the Auditor General discusses to the public, that public at Article 10 is entitled to transparency backwards.
Yes.
So we must get a feedback report as the Kenyan people under Article 10 on what Parliament agreed to do and who was meant to do, so that the process of reporting back the conclusion is self-proof.
All right.
And that's where the DPP also, under the same structure of Chapter 15 of our Constitution,
uh-huh.
is required also to update Parliament. So our structure of Constitution is self-talking.
Mm.
To each other.
Yeah.
Okay, we're running out of time. Johnson, I'd just like you to respond, because today, if you look at the National Audit website, there's a statement there by the Auditor General, and it's talking about constrictions of funding, especially now that, you know, we have two levels of government, the national government and the county government, and saying we could well do with more funds to be able to exercise our mandate effectively.
Mm.
You're in the Finance Committee in Parliament, and a parliamentarian talking about the funds. Could you just comment to that really quickly?
Two things. We've done quite a lot in strengthening the Office of the Auditor General over the years. If you compare it with 3 years ago, clearly it is a stronger office, and the strengthening of the Office of the Auditor General is within the interest of the people of Kenya. If you look at the budgetary allocations, even over the last 3 years, there's been an increase. I remember having a discussion with the Auditor General himself during budget process in the last financial year, and he had requested certain additions, and which Parliament actually did. That has been done. However, if you look at some of the recommendations that Auditor General's office had, especially when we're looking at the public audit bill, some of those, of course, would not be, you know, implementable, because one of them was that the office of the Auditor General wanted to be able to take the budget directly, you know, to Parliament, like the other three arms of government. Mm-hmm. The only, you know, arms that are able to do that is the judiciary, the Parliamentary Service Commission, and then the executive brings it.
Right.
And the middle ground, I remember that we were able to broker, and I was very firm on that at that discussion, because I was in the mediation committee, was that, of course, in the past, cabinet secretaries or ministers of finance have been, you know, either denying the Auditor General's office money, or changing the budgets, you know, before it comes to Parliament. So he said, let the budget go to the cabinet secretary because of the bird's eye view over the economy, but not for the cabinet secretary to amend it or to change anything, but to give his accompanying comments to it. The final mandate to determine how much money goes to that particular office is will always be the National Assembly.
Okay.
And
all right.
That's how it should be.
All right. Thank you. Final comments from you, Kwame, as we close.
Okay. I think that Parliament, I mean, prosecution. Okay. Let's first start with this. The purpose of an audit is not necessarily to recommend prosecution by anybody, or even to suggest that crime has taken place. But one of the things that it does, it helps whether an institution or the public sector in general to find out how to live cleanly with a good public finance management system and to respect the laws that are in place. A summary of the report, which is all I've read, tells you that we are doing badly. And we're not doing badly because of anything else. We are doing badly because Parliament is not executing. One, I think it's too easily, it's beholden too much to the executive. For that reason, it seems to actually place the Auditor General on its defense. So you prove to us that they haven't, when the reverse should actually be the case. So that's the first thing. The second thing that Parliament needs to do is, if, for instance, we cannot balance every flow, I mean, starting from the revenues, are not balanced. 2.7 billion shillings are unexplained, in the sense that, yes, it was collected, but it never got to our exchequer. 2.7 billion shillings, that's a very serious problem. And this is a problem Parliament has dealt with before. So what it means is that somebody somewhere is playing around with the figures. So you don't even know when you're presented with budgets for 2.25 trillion, that's actually what is being spent. Public finance systems are actually a mess. And largely because Parliament does not use its power of appropriations to actually ask people or ask departments to respond by saying, look, if your interests are pending for 2 years, we can't fund you. We can't. So your power to defund specific departments of state, whether in the executive or other areas, is one you have never used. And that's why this mess is here. It's not for the executive to solve, to be honest. The executive is sure that they have competent staff, even if that staff does not take, takes money and does not receive for them.
All right, you must respond to that in a minute.
I must also respond and make final comments as he is. Number one, you see, if you look at Parliament, there is an overwhelming majority of Jubilee. But because of the primacy of the audit function and those issues, we agreed that so that people don't say, as he's saying, that Parliament is beholden to give the Public Accounts Committee and the Public Investments Committee a majority of the opposition and the leadership of those two committees. That's the leadership that has been there. So even if, you know, within that committee, if you say Jubilee members will not be happy with certain issues, the final report that comes out of the committee has never had a minority report of anybody who is dissenting from it. So it cannot be the executive having a hold on
All
Jubilee
right.
members.
But
to
close, really
I must
close.
Say,
we
I
really
must say
close.
That what Kenyans must get very clearly is that 67 billion shillings has not been stolen, as has been reported. There are certain issues either within the processes and with the accounting.
It just hasn't been accounted for.
It has been accounted for, but it was not put at the time of that report, and that's what we want to know, why those responses were not put in. Simple
right.
as that.
Okay, we really need to close.
One final thing is on IFMIS.
Oh, my goodness.
That the total report begs to question the famous tracking system in IFMIS.
Of IFMIS, okay.
Because the
All
auditor
right.
should not have been unable to track anything on a soft copy.
All right, Karithi, we really must end it now. We've taken quite a bit of time.
You have more time
for we've had a little more than half an hour. But thank you all for coming in. Karithi Muremi, Johnson Sakaja, and Kwame Owino. Keep your thoughts coming in, and we'll continue to sample them. This is Chess.